Good evening and welcome. This is your Polish American Connection TV show, and I'm the producer and host, Tom Gajewski. We want to welcome you, and we think you're going to find this program to be interesting. You know, last program we talked about East Reading, and we had a very strong response to it, and I think it was because of the guest we had here and also the topic. So we hope you'll join us with some further discussions there, and we'll tell you a little more about what we're going to cover in just a minute. But I want to remind you that you ought to get a pencil and paper, because we will be announcing a number of upcoming events at the end. And I also want to remind you that this is a two-way program. You're welcome to call in, give your comment, or raise a question, and we will be happy to answer. The only thing we ask is that you please state your question or make your comment, and then give our guest or me an opportunity to answer. The number to call for that is 610-378-0426. 610-378-0426. And we didn't get a chance to do it at the last show, but we wanted to congratulate the folks involved with the Oktoberfest. It was a very huge success again, and Liederkranz can certainly be proud of that, as can all of Berks County, because it's one of the biggest in the world. So with that, I'd like to introduce our guest, and again, his voice is one that a lot of people have heard, and maybe you haven't seen his face, but he's getting even more famous now because he's become an author. So he's expanding into other areas to show what talents he has. And the Polish community really should be very proud of the fact that we have an author in our midst, a successful author, because Paul's books are selling, and we hope that he has a lot more success in the future. And with that, I'd like to welcome Paul Druzba. Paul?
Thank you, Tom.
Thanks for being here.
It's nice to be here.
You've written two books so far, right?
I have, yes, and well, let's see, I can...
Can we take the Neversink one first?
Sure. This is the first one that I wrote. This one was published in 2003, and the version that I'm holding was published in 2012, and this is called Neversink, Reading's Other Mountain. It's a history of Neversink Mountain during the resort years when there were a lot of hotels and things like that up there. And this is the expanded edition, which is about a third larger than the original that I put out. It's got a lot more stories and a lot more pictures and stuff in it. And the other book, this is my second book, my newest book. It's called Pandora, Forgotten Trolley Park of Reading. And this was just published earlier this year. And that's part of the reason, I guess, why I'm here, is because a lot of it has to do with East Reading. And the people of East Reading, and they are, if anybody is responsible for Pandora being a playground instead of a housing development, it's the people of East Reading. So they should be proud of themselves for that fact, and it really is a beautiful place. And you know, it's not perfect. No city park or playground is perfect, but you know, Pandora comes pretty close. So you know, there's a lot of good stuff going on there, and I'm really proud to you know, be able to tell the story of it.
Can you give us kind of a thumbnail sketch?
Sure.
of the history of it?
Absolutely. If you can go to a picture, I have a picture that I would like to show, and this really kind of begins my memories of Pandora Park. This is the baseball field, and this is where I would play up there with my miserable 12th and Chestnut playground baseball team. I can remember one particular day where we lost to Reading Iron 23-1.
Whoa.
It was really a humiliating day, but and you know, the baseball field at that time, because I was a little kid, it seemed so big. I mean, it seemed like, you know, 2 miles to first base, and because it was a hardball field, and you know, there was no, you know, bringing the bases in for the kids or anything. We played on the regular field. At that time, when I was a kid, some of you may remember this, there was also a softball field which was way out in where center field is, and facing the other baseball field. This was removed sometime in the 1950s, but or maybe early 60s, but there used to be a softball field out there as well. And at any rate, I'm trying to think of how I don't remember how to change pictures, so I guess maybe I should just come back here. There are a lot of other things that, you know, are really connected with Pandora. In 1998, we celebrated Reading's 250th anniversary, and I went up there and I volunteered for a while. There was a woman named Ruth Epler who was, at that time, I think she was the treasurer of the Pandora Association, which is really, you know, those are the people who really made all the improvements to Pandora. And if it weren't for people like her, I don't know that the playground even would have survived. Everybody knows what happened to Carsonia Park in 1950, and there was pressure for that at Pandora much earlier than that, back in the 1920s. There were people who wanted to make houses out of it. That portion of East Reading, including Cotton Street, before that time, Perkiomen Avenue was really the only thing that was developed. And it took a while for the development to filter back to Cotton Street and eventually all the way up to Fairview. It took many years for all those houses to fill in back there. And they were filling in on the other side of the street, too. Forest Street and 18th Street, all those places were, you know, starting to fill up with homes. And they could have put a lot of homes, probably 50 or 60 or so, in Pandora Park. And so, but the people in the neighborhood knew that, you know, they needed to try to keep this together. But the book talks about a lot of things. It talks about pools, for one thing, swimming pools. Back in the 20s, swimming pools were a big deal. And of course, when the amusement park at Pandora, which only lasted for 4 years, when that folded because of a fire, an arson fire, by the way, they still had the big lake. There was a big lake where the baseball field is now. And that was part of the park. And after the park burned down, the lake was still there. And the kids used to go swimming in the lake, even though they really weren't supposed to. but they started playing up there. And, you know, they actually started to form teams. And the city kind of adopted them as a real playground. And they had their own baseball teams and their own volleyball teams and stuff like that. And they were actually winning against other playgrounds. And the city didn't even own the property. It took the people in East Reading 6 years to convince the city of Reading to buy the property up there. Finally, in 1920, the city bought it. There's so much stuff in here. I mean, we talk about the zoo. There was a zoo in Pandora. It started kind of... it depends where you draw the lines for Pandora. Some people would have said it was in Mineral Spring Park, but it, you know, in the present day, it's in Pandora. And the zoo was there about 15 years altogether. And there were a lot of
free?
People.
Was that free, Paul?
It was free, yep. It was owned by the city, and it was neglected by the city, and eventually had to be shut down because the city just neglected the daylights out of the zoo. And there were a lot of complaints from the Humane Society that the animals weren't being treated right. They had a zookeeper and everything, but the problem is that the zookeeper had five other things to do as part of his job. And he just didn't have time to really care for the animals the way they should have been. But over the years, there were so many things that happened. I mean, just the story of the amusement park at Pandora is fascinating because it was really serious competition for Carsonia. And a lot of the things that were being done at Pandora were copied immediately afterwards by Carsonia Park.
You made an interesting point about the fireworks there, too.
Yeah, one of the big things that a lot of people remember are the fireworks. The fireworks took place in Pandora until about the mid-60s. They were shot off near the woods over around the third base side of the baseball field. And, of course, there are a lot of trees over there, and it caused a lot of problems with fires. But, you know, from early on, I mean, from back in the 1920s, especially in the 1930s, when the field house was being built and the wading pool was first being built, they had fireworks then, too. And there's a picture that I have in the book of the stage area with the field house in the background. And there were 20,000 people that showed up at Pandora that day on the 4th of July. There hadn't been that many people at Pandora since opening day of the amusement park back in 1907. Hmm. So it was really a big deal. And again, in the 60s, my wife remembers going to fireworks at Pandora in the mid-60s when her family was still living in Reading. And it was terrific, but there was one incident at the last one that they went to where there was a firework that came very close to where they were, and it was still burning. And my father-in-law, future father-in-law, got kind of freaked out by this, and he said, "We're not going back there anymore." But it was the best fireworks in town. And mainly it was paid for by, again, the people of East Reading. It was not the city. At one point, the Pandora had the best lights of any baseball field in Reading. And again, the people in the community paid for that and not the city.
And I remember, too, on Cotton Street, after the fireworks on the 4th of July, the cars would be bumper to bumper all the way down Cotton Street.
Yeah.
That's how popular that was.
Yeah, and if you want to get a taste of what that feels like, go out to Shillington sometime on the last
community
day of community days.
Yeah.
It's crazy out there. You can't get within a mile of the place.
That's one thing, too, I like about your book is you talked about pictures. I know you have a number of pictures in there, too, and
I do.
I think your book is worth the price just to see those pictures.
Thank you. So. I wish I could remember how to change the pictures on here, but there are lots in here. One thing I would like to find on here, if I can, is, let me try this. Hey, there we go.
You have an old picture, don't you?
Well, this is something that's going to kind of lead into what we want to talk about also.
Mm-hmm.
This is a map. It's an atlas map from 1884, a little bit before your time, the viewers who are watching, and a bit before Tom and my time, too. But
let's not tell them how old we are.
No, we won't get into that. But part of this, and I know that this is probably too small for viewers to really be able to make out details, but in the lower right portion of it, there's a street called 12th and a Half Street, which at that time was between 12th Street and 13th. Later on, that street was changed to Chapel Terrace, and that was my street. That's where I grew up. And right behind my house on this map is a place called J.S. Richards School. And it was a public school. It was built in 1872, and it was torn down finally in 1935. And from about the 50s, I'd say, on, there was a playground there. Also, in the middle of the picture, which is between Muhlenberg and Cotton Street, and between, say, 11th and Chapel Terrace, was an ice dam. And it was right around where the Reading Dairy used to be. And it was a huge ice dam. And right above it, on Cotton Street, was an ice house. And that's where the ice that was harvested from the dam lake would be stored until it was sold to restaurants or, you know, bars or wherever the ice was going.
Hmm. How about that?
So that kind of leads into the Cotton Street thing. Maybe we can touch a little bit on some of that, because I know your family was from that area.
Yeah, and in fact, one thing I wanted to mention, and you're certainly aware of this, both of us were interviewed by Steve Henshaw from the newspaper,
and, right.
And Steve, sometime in the coming weeks, and I talked to him, and he said it looks like it'll be sometime in November. Mm-hmm. Sunday Eagle will have an article that will talk about East Reading as it was back in the 50s and 60s. And mm-hmm. I know Paul's contributed to that, and I've given him a couple of suggestions too. So keep an eye out for that. I don't know the exact date, but it should be coming up soon.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to that.
Yeah, me too. But we thought we'd talk a little bit about Cotton Street, and why don't we start down at 9th, and I remember there was a beauty parlor on the corner there. I don't know if you remember that.
No, I don't. Cotton Street was about four or five blocks, I guess, away from where I lived, and I know that my family had a couple of establishments up there. My dad's uncle, I believe, was his name Walter. He had a hotel at 12th and Cotton. Mm. At a hotel meaning a bar. they used to call them hotels back in those days, but they weren't really hotels. They were bars. Bars and restaurants. And but I was never there, and I really don't know. That was before my time.
Mm-hmm. I think that became Mamie's after that.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay, all right.
If you remember Mamie's at all?
No, I don't. I don't. That was, again, it was kind of out of my neighborhood, except for the occasions when I used to go with some buddies. We would go up to Neversink and play, or else we would go up to 10th and South Playground, which is Neversink. But, you know, I never really hung around Cotton Street because I didn't know anybody that lived up there.
Well, and on that western side of Cotton Street, one of the establishments that we got to mention is Boo Boo's. Mm-hmm. And of course that was Bill Leonardjack and his wife that started that, and he became a councilman, and then his son Eddie became a councilman. And I remember my dad used to like to frequent that place on a Friday night. That mm-hmm. was kind of a place for the guys from Cotton Street to go, and they'd play pinochle. Mm. Of course, they'd have a beer or two.
Just a couple.
Yeah, zimno pivo, as they say. And a little vodka. But seriously, that was a gathering place. And then and there were bars, I think, at almost every corner back then.
Yeah, my mother's family lived up on 13th Street at Kenny, mm-hmm. and there was a bar down at the corner on Cotton Street. Mm-hmm. And my grandfather hung down there a lot, more than he should have, and so did several of my uncles. So mm-hmm. that was their favorite watering hole.
And you mentioned 12th, I don't know if it's open now, but there was a bar that was open there just till a few years ago. Hmm. And then there was also a beauty parlor, and there's a beauty parlor in there now, and I think that's on the northwest corner. And then northeast corner was Tony and Ed's. Hmm. And that was a confectionery store where they had ice cream and comic books and mm-hmm. penny candy and that kind of stuff.
Wow.
And that was near where I lived, and I remember on a Sunday night we'd look around the house to see if we could get enough nickels to buy an ice cream sundae.
One thing I found in my research for the Pandora book was mm-hmm. that right across the street from the hotel bar at 13th and Cotton, there used to be a playground there. Mm. And there wasn't when I was a kid. I mean, there was always like a gas station or something there when I was a kid. It was an Atlantic station.
Atlantic gas
station,
because they used to give out those red balls.
Yeah. But right before that, there used to be a playground there. And unbeknownst to me, my mom and dad may have actually met there. Mm. My mom was working at the playground. She was in charge of the sandbox that day, I think. And my dad was there playing the accordion. Mm. And I don't know if they really knew each other, especially romantically at that point, because they would have been like 14 or 15 at the time. Mm-hmm. But they were both in the same place at the same time. That was my mom's neighborhood, mm-hmm. but it was not my dad's neighborhood. Mm-hmm. So he must have come there for a reason, and I don't think the playground was the reason.
And then Konopelski's, the store, was in the 1500 block.
Is that, I remember going up there a lot because nobody, I mean, the kielbasa was just, you know, without parallel. I mean, you get a lot of arguments from people around about which is the best kielbasa, but to me, there is no argument. It's, Konopelski.
As far as I remember, every Christmas the talk was, well, when are we going to Konopelski's to get sausage?
Mm-hmm. So. yep.
And then up from there was Tax, and I think they opened like in 1946.
Yeah, there's a picture in here.
In fact, Frank Tack, and I guess their name correctly spelled, I think, is T-Y-A-C or something.
Or T-K-A-C, I think it is.
Okay. It's not T-A-C-K, though.
No. Now, the picture that you're looking at right now, by the way, is taken from Tax. Hmm. If you're standing outside Tax, which I was when I took this, you can see the pagoda up there and 16th Street. And there's another picture I took of that big exhaust fan on the side with that mm-hmm. with that cute little sign they have out front. I understand Tax has a place over in Shillington now that they've opened up.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's called Tax Pizza.
How about that?
And I can't wait to go over there because they make a pizza just like their steak sandwich.
Oh, wow, that sauce is great.
I gotta have one of those.
Yeah, they have a special too on a Sunday. You can get a large cheesesteak for $5.50. I've been
hitting
it on a couple of occasions.
Maybe this Sunday.
Yeah, there you go. Well, as much as I'd like to keep talking about this, I think we better get to our events so we have enough time with them. If we could please have Paul Druzba's book. There you can see. Paul, you want to tell them where they can get your book?
Yeah, a lot of people have asked me, and because of not being associated with like a major publisher, I'm a very minor publisher, which is me. But you can get my book, both of my books, at the Berks History Center, which used to be called the Historical Society. You can also get them at the Pagoda Gift Shop, which is open Fridays and Saturdays, I think. The Berks Heritage Center, that's over in Burn Township behind St. Joe's. And you can also get them on eBay. And I would suggest that if you put a search up on eBay, you'll find the book. Make sure it goes for $16.95. There's a guy who also buys my books from someplace and resells them on eBay for about $10 more than I charge for them. So, hey, whatever. I mean, this is free enterprise, and, you know, that's what America's all about. But, you know, if you don't want to spend too much money, look for the one that I sell.
and really, the books are worth it just for the pictures. The price is worth it.
Thank you.
Polish American Heritage Association has its November meeting on Sunday, November 15th at 2 o'clock at the Goggle Works. Free parking. Guests are welcome. Polish American Cultural Center at the Goggle Works also at 2nd and Washington Streets. Open Saturdays and Sundays, 11 to 4. Free admission, free parking. Gives you a chance to learn about the Polish culture and heritage. Volunteers are needed there. Looking for a minimum commitment of 2 hours a month. And if you're interested, call Marilyn at 610-779-5523. Polish radio program, Walt the K's Poker Party, Sundays 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. WRW 1340 a.m. Karen's Music Festival, Sunday 10 to 12 noon. WEEU 8:30 a.m. Jimmy Sturr's Polka Hour, Sunday 12 noon to 1 p.m. on WEEU 8:30. And then there's a Polish American radio program at the address that's listed. Gettysburg Polish Pottery, number to call there is 717-479-1083, and they're on Baltimore Street in Gettysburg. Polish t-shirts and novelty buttons at Christina's Kitchen in the Fairgrounds Market, 610-507-4158. Polish American Connection TV show. We air, of course, at this time, but then also this coming Friday at 1:30 p.m., next Monday at 10:30 a.m., and Tuesday at 3:30 p.m., Comcast Channels 15 and Service Electric Channel 19. And again, you can get Paul Druzba's book at the Berks History Center, the former Historical Society at 940 Center Avenue in Reading. The Pagoda on Fridays and Saturdays, Paul?
Right? I think so.
And the Berks Heritage Center, and also on eBay. And I'm not exaggerating to say that if you're interested in East Reading and Pandora Park and something on the Neversink Mountain, you may want to, just for the sake of the pictures, the books are definitely worth the price and bring back a lot of good memories. So thank you, Paul, for being here.
It was a pleasure.
Yeah, I think we had fun. At least I did. and like to say to everyone, thanks for watching, and take care, God bless, and always be proud to be Polish.